A very good morning to all of you. I welcome you all to the ICANN initiative, the Hindu and Indian Express analysis. So we will start the day with the story of the day. So yesterday I happened to meet a person and during interaction, she told me a very nice story that I want to share with you all. So this particular story is on solving a problem or problem solving approach. So if you have seen Ramayana during the lockdown period, or if you have even seen it earlier, you know that Lakshman, when he gets unconscious during fight with Ravan, so that time Hanuman is sent to get this Sanjeevani booty from a parvat called as a Sumeru Parvat. So when he goes there and he lands on the Sumeru Parvat, he is not able to identify the Sanjeevani booty. So that time he needs to somehow find out where that Sanjeevani booty is and then take it as soon as possible. So what Hanuman does is, first of all, he comes out of the Sumeru Parvat. So if he is still landing on Sumeru Parvat, he is unable to see where the solution is. So where the Sanjeevani booty is, he is unable to see. So first he comes outside of the Sumeru Parvat, and then he has an overall perspective of the, an overall view of the Parvat. So this shows that whenever you are faced with any problem, the first thing that you should do is to think from the point of a third person, to have a detached opinion, to have a detached perspective regarding the problem. So when we are in problems, we usually try to get very emotional about it and start blaming things around. But when you have a third person's approach or a third person's perspective, you get a detached view of the problem and you think it in terms of the fact that there is a problem and a solution needs to be found. The second thing that Hanuman does is he grows himself so big that the parvat becomes very tiny in front of it. And this is very true for the problems in our lives also. Whenever we are faced with any problem, we make the problem larger than life, but that should never happen. Whatever problem it is, you have the capacity in you to find a solution to this problem. And any problem in life is much, much smaller than yourself, than your abilities to solve the problem. So always see problems as small things in life which will come and go, and you have that strength within you to face no matter what comes your way. So this is how our problem solving approach should be. And this is more important for a civil servant, because every day he faces innumerable number of challenges and problems. What seems insurmountable in the beginning, he will eventually have to win over it. So this is possible only when he sees it from a third perspective, a detached view of the problem, from the point of view that this is a problem and it needs to be solved. And also, no problem is seen as a larger than life experience. So every problem is a small thing. It's just a speck of a dust, and it's going to, that too will pass. So this should be our approach. And yes, you can use it in ethics and in essays, because these kinds of issues these days are very common in the questions. So even if there is a question on emotional intelligence, so you can use these kinds of stories, because only an emotionally balanced person is able to take a balanced perspective of the problem and think that it is a problem which requires a solution and not see it as an existential crisis itself. So with this, we will start with the first topic. Yeah, before that, it's actually good to see that after covering now nearly for 2 months and 10 days, what we see is several of the topics that we have covered in the past are now started to repeat themselves. So it, whenever I read the newspaper, I feel so better. Even if I was an aspirant, I feel so so good that I have already covered these topics, and there is so much of repetition, and the amount of time that I need to spend reading the newspaper is now started to reduce. So this is going to happen even more so in the future if you're following consistently. So there was one article on the India-China standoff, which is again comprehensively covered. Then regarding private participation in the space sector, that is also covered. Then India-Nepal relations, the recent border issue and the political map controversy, that is also done. And then the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, in that the whatever was done for the farming sector, that is the Essential Commodities Act and the APMC reforms, that was also covered. And then finally, regarding food security, so we have dealt that in detail. So that is also done. So these five articles were very well covered previously, and there was nothing new in these articles. So the first topic is monetization of deficit. Now, this article has been written in this context of the Moody's downgrade of India. So Moody had downgraded India's status from BAA2 to BAA3. Now, why I'm mentioning this specifically is that it is not important to know what is BAA2 or what BAA3 is. So don't spend your, or rather I would say, don't waste your time and effort to know something that you know you will never have the time and space to write in the exam. You will never get a question like, what is Moody's upgrade? What are the categories? You won't get any such question. So at max, you will be mentioning in your answer that Moody's had downgraded. So if there is a question on what according to you is the status of Indian economy or something like that, so you will be just making a passing reference to the Moody's downgrade. And you will be focusing more on the issues which led to the downgrade rather than on these technicalities of BA2 and 3. So you don't have to worry about all these things, and don't waste time looking at what these things are. Coming back to this, this article was in the context of the Moody's downgrade of India's from India's credit rating from BA2 to BA3. So this is a point where we have to start looking at the India's fundamentals, like what went wrong. So before that, we will see why this downgrade matters. So this downgrade matters because the first thing is that whenever there is a downgrade, the foreign institutional investors will start to flee the Indian markets. So whatever dollars or they have invested in the Indian market is going to fly away from India. They are going to withdraw from India. So when these foreign currencies are being withdrawn from India, it will lead to rupee depreciation. So rupee depreciation can in turn lead to inflation. And the second is, when forex reserves, these dollars are being withdrawn by FII, it could also lead to forex crisis. So that is another thing. And when these FII investments are being withdrawn, it will definitely affect the stock and the bond markets also. So they will also suffer. So that is why it is important that attention is paid to these credit rating agencies, whatever rating they are given, that is why attention is paid to them. But what is more important for us to see is the cause or the reasons for the downgrade. So Moody's has told that there are basically three reasons why this downgrade has happened. One is, there was a slowing growth that was happening in India. Second is, there was an increasing public debt. And third is, the financial sector weakness. Now we will see some data related to these things. So in this whole article, more than you'll never be asked a question, why did Moody's downgraded the India's rating, and you will be writing these three things. No, you will rather have a general question asking about the status of Indian economy. So in which case you will need some data to make your answer more strong. So that is why we are discussing this. So the first thing that you have to know is regarding the fiscal deficit. So the combined fiscal deficit of the center and the states is expected to be 12% of GDP in this year. So this is one thing, so which shows how slow growth is there. And the second thing is about the public debt. So public debt was earlier 72% of GDP, and now in 2020-21 fiscal, it is going to be 84% of the GDP. So this is regarding the public debt. So these are important data which you will be using to substantiate in your answers. The third thing is regarding the financial sector weakness. So this is mainly measured in terms of the non-performing assets. So non-performing assets, even before the pandemic started, was more than 9% of the advances of the banks. So this again shows the financial sector weakness. So these are very important data. Depending upon the question, you will be using them. So now, because of all these, there is a slowdown in the economy, there is a recession. So all that is happening. In such a case, during this time, the pandemic has also hit. So one thing that this downgrade says is that the slowdown in the economy had started much before the pandemic. It started last year. And two, that now, even because the pandemic is also there, the aggregate demand has also fallen a lot. So now the government should come out with discretionary fiscal stimulus in order to give a stimulus to the economy to start growing. Now, in this case, there are two options for the government to give a fiscal stimulus, or rather three options. One is taxing the people more. So this is not possible, it is ruled out. So taxing the people more cannot be done, particularly when people are losing jobs and losing incomes. The second thing is by borrowing more. Already the public debt is now 72%, which is going to increase to 84% of GDP. So, and this increasing public debt has itself led to a downgrade by the Moody's, and we know why such a downgrade is important for us. So this option is also not very much possible. The third option is the monetization of deficit. So whenever the government runs a deficit, it could be monetized when the RBI gives money to the government. So this could be either through printing of new notes, or it could be through buying of say treasury bills. It could be through any of these means that the deficit could be monetized. But usually experts don't suggest that the deficit be monetized. So there are reasons, like for instance, if the deficit is monetized by printing more money, it will lead to more inflationary pressures in the economy. So which is not good for the people again. So because of this, it is usually not recommended. But this particular article, it argues why monetization of deficit is not all that bad, and why it is a safe option that the government can explore to mobilize more resources. The first argument it gives is that the basic reason why the monetization of deficit is opposed is because it will lead to inflationary pressures in the economy. But in the current economy, during the pandemic, the demand itself is very low. The aggregate demand has fallen very sharply. So because of this, whenever, even if the deficit is monetized, it will actually go to increasing the actual output in the economy. So when the output is increased, it may not lead to any inflationary pressures. So this monetization of deficit could help in increasing the output without an increase in the inflation, because the aggregate demand itself has fallen and MOD is only going to improve the output in the economy. So that is the first argument. The second argument supporting monetization of deficit is that even when the RBI does the open market operations means where the RBI purchases the government, purchase or selling of the government bonds in the secondary market. So when RBI is doing the open market operations, that is purchasing the government bonds in the secondary market, even that is leading to an impact on the money supply in the economy. So even this could lead to inflationary pressures if we see that way. But still, open market operation is considered to be a lesser evil. It is considered to be more safe, reason being the impact that OMO is going to have on the RBI's balance sheet is temporary. But the impact the MOD is going to have on the RBI's balance sheet is permanent. So that is the only difference. But however, even if you look at the past open market operations, they last for long periods of time. The effects which we are calling as temporary on the RBI balance sheet, even they are lasting for a longer periods of time, and they are having identical effects on inflation. So it is not that OMO is a safe instrument. So when OMO is already done, then MOD could also be done. That is a thing. And third thing is that now already the public debt to GDP ratio is as high as 72%, which is estimated to increase to 84%. So if we further try to mobilize money by borrowing more, it could lead to a further downgrade in our credit rating by these credit rating agencies. So this borrowing by debt is not an option for us, and taxing people is not an option for us. So this is a safe option. So this is what the article is arguing. So you must be prepared for a question like, what is monetization of deficit, and pros and cons of that. So that could be a good question. So next is, we will look at few things related to local governance. So in this article, it said that during the COVID crisis, decentralizing the power to the local governance institutions will be very beneficial. So we have already seen several examples in this regard. We have seen how decentralization and the empowered local self-governance institutions in Kerala and the Kudumbashree self-help groups have been very helpful in tackling the pandemic. And we have seen the role of Pune Zilla Parishad also. So we have seen several examples during the course of this over 2 months period. So in this article, some of the data also we have already discussed. I'm included this to just make you revise that data. So Economic Survey 2017 and 18, it pointed out that the urban local governance bodies, they are able to get 44% of their revenue from their own sources. They are able to collect that much from the urban electorate. So 44% of the revenue of these urban local governance bodies is coming from their own sources. But for rural local governance bodies, the revenue that they are themselves generating is just 5%. This shows a very heavy dependence on finances from the state. So this is one data that you have to remember. So this shows that the rural bodies, that is the panchayats, they have to be given more funds. There must be more funds at their disposal if they have to do any meaningful work which has been assigned to them. The second important data that this article spoke about was the potential of the property tax. So property tax collections have fallen, and the potential of the property tax has not been realized. So several of these properties in the urban areas are exempted, and many of these are not authorized. They are these squatter settlements and all, which cannot be authorized so that you can collect property tax. And the urban areas are constantly growing. So the properties in the peri-urban, in the fringes of the urban areas, there is no clear-cut this thing that a property tax can be levied on them. So there are all of these things. And the urban local bodies also, they are not very keen on collecting the property tax because they fear that they might displease their electorate and therefore they might not get elected next year. So they are not very keen on all these things. So this is one thing, and there is no particular database of all the properties in a one municipality. So that database is also not there. So that is why the share of property tax in India in 2017-18 was only 0.14% of GDP. So this is the share of property tax in India. But if you look at the OECD countries, the share of property tax compared to their total GDP is 2.1%. So this shows that the potential of property tax in India has not been utilized. So that is one thing. And for this, this article has also suggested a few measures, like for instance, land monetization. Land monetization means what? There is a land that is there, and that could be used as a resource. For instance, if there is a vacant land, so on this, you some sort of exhibition, some sort of mela or something could be set up so that, or it could be leased out for some purpose for some time so that you can get monetary value from utilization of that land. So that is land monetization. So various options for land monetization can be seen. So that is one thing, land monetization. And second is betterment levy. Betterment levy is, so whenever there is some development that is happening in a particular area, it will lead to the uplifting in the status of the residents in that area. For instance, if a metro gets developed, so the nearby area will become very expensive, the land value will increase, the house rents become more. So therefore, whenever such developments happen, whenever there is any betterment that is happening, so the people in and around could be charged a betterment levy because they are enjoying the benefits of that development. So that is betterment levy. So this could also, various options of betterment levy could also be explored so that these bodies get additional sources of finances. And the third thing that is recommended is regarding the MPLAD scheme. So MPLAD scheme, again, we have discussed in detail the pros, cons, everything. So MPLAD scheme should, the money doesn't go to the these rural bodies or the panchayats. So the money is directly given to the district authorities for implementing the project suggested by the members of the parliament. So that is why these funds, it is said that this is against the principle of decentralized local self-governance. And therefore the funds under the MPLAD should be given directly to the local governments on the basis of a well-defined criteria so that this money can help them in dealing and taking out their and performing their duties. So that is another thing. And now, especially at the time of COVID crisis, it's all the more important that these local bodies are the first recipients or the first responders to these situations. So they have to be empowered with more flexible finances. So the 15th Finance Commission has given 90,000 crore grant for the local governance for the year 2020-21. But now, because of the COVID crisis, a special COVID containment grant should also be given to these bodies on the basis of a well-defined criteria that may be laid down by the State Finance Commission. So this is another thing, that is a special COVID containment grant. So that is another way by which these local bodies can be empowered by giving them more flexible finances. So we go to the next topic of e-diplomacy. So here again, we have already seen a lot in virtual diplomacy or digital diplomacy, e-diplomacy. We have seen several examples. So the added whatever the value addition that I got from this particular article was that first thing is, again, yes, we have used e-diplomacy in conducting the SAARC summit, in the G20 summit, in the NAM summit, and now recently in the Modi-Morrison virtual meet between India and Australia. So there have been innumerable examples of virtual diplomacy that have been conducted in this period of COVID crisis. So that is one thing. But what the article argues is that there is no replacement to a face-to-face interactions. So there is a popular British scholar. The name is Ernst Satow. So this British scholar has remarked that the summits are a permanent feature of the diplomacy. So in this case, it shows that how it is in fact always considered that whenever there are face-to-face interactions between two countries or the leaders of two countries, that marks the zenith of diplomatic relations. That is the peak of the diplomatic relations. So that is why the British scholar has also said that the summits form a permanent feature of diplomatic topography. So that is what the scholar has said. So this shows the importance of having face-to-face interactions. So all those closed door restricted sessions, the photographs and the outreach to the audience in a live manner. So all these are part and parcel of diplomacy. And now because of the virtual diplomacy, all of these things cannot happen. And also, if you look at the kind of issues between the two countries, many of these issues could be very complex. It could involve a lot of interests of so many stakeholders. So therefore, it is very difficult in the case of virtual diplomacy to have any deliverable to say so, because there are several things which are involved and there are several sticking points which need ironing out. But that is possible only in the case of a face-to-face interaction. So therefore, it is said that virtual diplomacy may not satisfy the broader political goals and the bigger objectives that only a face-to-face meeting can do. And second important drawback of the e-diplomacy is regarding the cyber insecurity. So during these discussions, so if there are any new proposals will have to be announced, which have some geostrategic implications or alignments, so something that is very secretive. So all of these things cannot be done in the virtual diplomacy because there is always a fear of being hacked and all the confidential things being leaked. So this is another drawback of virtual diplomacy. So this is what it is. But however, the article concludes by saying that yet, having some summit is definitely better than having no summit. So in this case of crisis, we can definitely go for virtual summits. But later on, we need to have a combination of virtual summits and the physical summits. So even though virtual summits are easy because you don't have to travel, you can be at the comfort of your place of residence and you can do it. But definitely to iron out the sticking points, to come out with some strategic or very important confidential things, agreements, for that it requires face-to-face agreements or face-to-face talks. So next is the role of NGO. So this is an example under the role of NGO. So in this case, the Bachpan Bachao Andolan, which is an NGO that is headed by Nobel Prize laureate Kailash Satyarthi. So this particular NGO, Bachpan Bachao Andolan, has gone to the Supreme Court and it has filed a petition by saying that when the national lockdown is now being lifted, there could be a considerable increase in the child trafficking for labor or prostitution. So therefore, it has alerted the court that it must ask the government to take requisite steps. So it has said that when the because of the lockdown, many of the poor people have been pushed to extreme poverty, and they have no option left now but to start doing away with their children. They might sell their kids, who could later on be laborers or could end up in prostitution. So there could be a spike in child trafficking because of the lockdown and the economic implications it has had on the poorest of the poor. So the NGO has alerted the Supreme Court, has filed a petition in the Supreme Court and alerted that during the period of opening, there could be a spike in child trafficking for labor and prostitution. So this, you can say, is the role of NGO. You can use it as an example. So next is regarding the health issues. So in this particular article, again, there were some very important data which you must know and use in your answers. So we will just discuss these data. The first important data is that because this is particularly important because of the COVID crisis, so we have nearly some 7.14 lakh beds are there, and we have nearly 36,000 intensive care units, and nearly 18,000 ventilators are there in India. So when you look at the number of beds, that is 7.14, it might seem, okay, this is a pretty good number. But you have to see it in the context of the India's population, which is very huge. So if you look in terms of the number of beds per 1,000 population, then that will come to just 0.53 beds per 1,000 population in India. But this is, even in Bangladesh, it is 0.87 beds per 1,000 population. In China, it is 4.34 beds per 1,000 population. So we are far, far behind, and therefore we need to increase the number of beds per 1,000 population, which means we need to increase the number of hospitals and the number of beds. So this is one data which is very important. The second data is even within the country, when you look at the differences in the states. So if you want to compare Kerala, which is one of the best performers, with Maharashtra, which is one of the worst affected now. So Kerala has a population of just 3.5 crores, while Maharashtra has a population of more than 12 crores. Okay, so in this regard, if you look at the number of hospital beds available in public hospitals in Kerala, it is nearly 22,000. 22,000 beds are available for a population of just 3.5 crores in Kerala in the public hospitals. But for Maharashtra, having a population of more than 12 crores, it has just nearly 7,000 beds. Just 7,000 beds are available in the public hospitals. So look at the difference. And this difference will also speak a lot about the capacities of these states in their capacity to contain the virus at a moderate level in their own states. So this matters a lot. So therefore, there is an urgent need to bridge these inequalities between the states, and there's an urgent need to mop up the healthcare infrastructure in all the states, especially the ones which are extremely badly hit now. So this is a second important data. The third is that if you look at the public and the private sector, nearly 62% of the total hospital beds in India are with the private sector, and 56% of the ventilators are with the private sector. So it shows how important the private sector is in, if you want to tackle any such emergent or such crisis situation. So the importance of private sector can be seen by this. And this is also a reminder to the government that every time it cannot rely on the private sector, because definitely private sector will ask money from people. So if 62% of the beds are with the private sector, it is an alarming situation, and it should alarm the government to increase its own capacities in a very quick manner. So these are the important data that was there in this article, which you should be using in your answers. So now we will discuss yesterday's question. I think one of you has already written the answer in the comment section. What I would also urge you all to do is to form a group, or rather what you can do is where it is uploaded in the website. So in the comment section there, each of you can upload your answers, and maybe if a good number of you are uploading your answers, I can visit the site every day and I can tell you that I can review it for you. Not, of course, all the answers, but some of the answers I will review every day, so that you will have a template, you will know how or what is to be written and what additions and deletions should be made. So that will help you also, and it will save my time and effort also. So that is one suggestion for you guys. So now, yesterday's question was regarding the pharmaceutical industry. So analyze the issues that the pharma industry in India is facing. So in the introduction, you will be writing about the status of pharmaceutical industry in India. So India is the third largest in volume and also 13th largest in value when it comes to the in the Indian pharmaceutical industry. We already know that India is the pharmacy of the world because it is the largest supplier of the generic drugs to the world. So this will form your introduction. Then you will directly start with the issues. So issues that this industry is facing. So when it comes to the issues, the first thing you can say is regarding the patent. So there are patented drugs in India, and the issue that these pharmaceutical industries are facing is related to India's patent regime, where the Supreme Court cases have all stopped the evergreening of patents, and India has also issued some compulsory licenses. So this is seen as a hindrance in starting pharma industries in India. That is one issue. The second issue is spurious medicine. So many of the drugs, they don't undergo very effective efficacy or safety trials, and because of which they are spurious drugs. So many of these drugs which has been exported to United States and various countries in the Europe, these markets have sent the drugs back because of they have raised quality issues and safety issues in the drugs. So that is also one very important issue. The third is also the talent pool. So which means that to develop these drugs, we need to have that talented mindset, those people who come out with these effective formulations which they think can cure the diseases and all that. So this basic talent pool is also missing. When you talk of the manpower that is required, that is also missing. The fourth thing is regarding the affordability. So many of these patented drugs are not affordable to a large section of our population. So given the average income levels of an Indian, so he may not be able to, he or she may not be able to afford these patented drugs. So the market as such itself is a problem for the pharma industry, that in the market, the people don't have so much of income to be able to afford the drugs. So that is another issue. So the market is not a very huge. That is one more thing. And next is, and a related issue to this is the insurance. So the insurance, when we talk of health insurance, it is usually given to the hospitalization. But just going and taking some drugs in the pharmacies, that for that no insurance coverage is there, and people are already expending a lot of money on, because so out of pocket expenditure is already high, so they are not able to afford these medicines because health insurance doesn't include that. And added to this, we also have these restrictions apart from the generic medicines and all that. We have the national list of essential medicines where the prices are capped by the government. So this is again another disincentive for the private sector to participate in the drug production. So this is also there. And then you can say, in fact, this is one of the most important, it should be said in the beginning itself. The active pharmaceutical ingredients. So this these form the raw materials for the manufacture of drugs, and we depend, 80% of this imports is coming from China. So in this case, I have told two different things. One is that API and the other is about China. So you can actually break this same point into two different points. In seventh point, you can write that we are dependent to a large extent on the active pharmaceutical ingredients, which act as raw materials for the manufacture of drugs. And next point, you can write as dependence on China. So this becomes your next point. And there you can say that 80% of the API imports happen from China. So given the India-China relations that are just undergo ups and downs, so it is not very wise to depend on China, particularly during these emergencies. It can do anything. So dependence on China becomes another point. And next point is that research and development. The research and development expenditure, again, from the from government point of view, is very less. So this again needs to be improved. So next is the government policies. So when you talk of government policies, the policy for establishing new units, raw material manufacturing units, incubators, all of these needs to be there. So that amount of flexibility has to be there when it comes to the at the policy level. So this again needs to be ensured, which is currently absent. So even if it is not asked, you will definitely, as a part of your way forward, make some suggestions. So you can write about the Kartoch Committee. Kartoch Committee on API recommended that we must be self-sufficient in API. We must reduce our imports. So for this, we have to revive the sick or dying pharmaceutical industries which are in the government sector. And also we must form this cluster-based approach. That is, there has to be a cluster scheme wherein you will be setting up mega parks which have some common facilities, like they may have common effluent treatment plants, they may have common laboratories, so that the pharma industry can enjoy the economies of scale. Then we must boost the research and development expenditure in this particular sector. We must have more industry, academia, research institution collaborations must be there. So we must have an easy and transparent regulatory regime should be there. And even the clinical trials. So many of the cases, the clinical trials have also been done without informed consent, which has raised many ethical issues also. So this was raised by another committee called as the Ranjit Chaudhary Committee. So all of these things, there must be more transparency in conducting of trials also. Then you can say that we have to have a government policy, as I said, for setting up the units, for manufacture of raw materials and incubators. All of these things is very important. Then we must also have a functional testing laboratory in every state, so that whatever manufactured is manufacturing is done, that safety is also tested. So all of these things are you can write as part of the way forward, and you can conclude your answer. So today's question, and many of you had written in the comment to discuss one ethics question. I will not say every day, but yeah, we will see. Usually I try to give a question that is linked with the topics that I discuss the same day, so that it will be more reinforced in your memory, and we can cover topic wise also. So today there was no much new topic that was there. So I'm giving this question: discuss the qualities which a civil servant should possess. Give examples from your own lives when you have displayed any two such qualities. See, remember that it'll always be useful if your efforts are collective, okay? So if you pull in the resources, then each of you, the amount of work that you have to do will be less. So same goes with the suggestion that I gave you all to write answers on the website every day. So I can also review, so that is another advantage that you will have. And when you, many people start writing answers there. So if 10 people write, each of you would have written at least one different point. So you can pull in all your points and you can form a very good answer. So collective efforts will always bear fruit. So take the suggestion seriously and try to do. So that's it for today. Thank you.